with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 4. Let me ask you a question here. Just help me get started this morning. What is the neatest, most exciting invitation you've ever received? Anybody just want to share? Coolest events you've ever been invited to? Who's going to help me out? Nick, you ever been invited on a hot date? Invited to a wedding you just couldn't wait to go to, a birthday party? Think about invitations. I want you to think about invitations this morning. Coolest thing you've ever been, most exciting thing you've ever been invited to. I think in my life, I've received some pretty exciting invitations. When I was a child, my grandpa used to invite me over to mow his yard. That was fun, you know. I did receive some invitations as a teenager to play on some City League baseball teams. I thought that was pretty neat. I've been invited to lunch meetings. I really don't care much for lunch meetings. Well, I'm not sure what those are all about. I mean, we can eat or we can meet. I don't like to join the two together. I've been invited to weddings, parties, dinners, concerts, to participate on committees, mission trips, preaching opportunities, been invited to ball games, been invited on hunting trips. One of the neatest invitations I've ever received happened just a little over a year ago when a nurse invited me into a back little room in the delivery room where I got to meet my granddaughter for the first time. I'll never forget that invitation. But the greatest invitation, the most incredible invitation I've ever received, was the invitation to follow Jesus Christ, my Lord. That's an invitation. That's the invitation I want to talk to you about this morning, an invitation to follow the King. Let me read this text to you. The calling, what we call the calling of the first disciples. Look with me in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. While walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them. And the text says, immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. It's an incredible text, one of my favorites in all of Scripture, in all the Gospels. The calling of the first disciples. I think this text teaches us some things about what it means to follow Jesus. As a matter of fact, as I explained it to you this morning, I want you to look at it this way. Four thoughts about an invitation to follow Jesus and what that involves, not just for these men, but for your life as well. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for our time together this morning. We're opening the Word, and let us focus our minds in on the Word of the Almighty, the Word of our Creator, the Word of our Sustainer. Help us to focus on the words of God and what they mean for our lives. This is a powerful invitation. Know that it is not just given to four fishermen, but it's given to people today. It's given to people sitting in this room. It has life-changing consequences. Help us to learn what an invitation to follow the King means for us today. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Four thoughts about what an invitation to follow Jesus involves. The first is this. This invitation that these men received happened in a routine moment. Routine moment. Now I want you to think about what we've seen take place in the book of Matthew up until this scene, how God has spoken, how he's revealed himself to those who he's spoken to, there's the miraculous conception. I would call that supernatural. That's a supernatural moment, a divine moment. You know, there's the angelic messengers, those who spoke to Joseph and those who spoke to the wise men. That's a supernatural moment. There's the celestial objects that guided the wise men from the east. That's a supernatural moment. And this just what we read a couple weeks ago, where the skies opened up and the Spirit of God descended and a voice from heaven, much like we read about Paul on the Damascus Road. And I think often when we think, well, we're going to hear from God and experience God and know God and have a moment with God, we expect it to be those kinds of supernatural moments. But what I realize when I read this text is that God is engaging his people in the routine moments of their lives. Think about it. It says he's out walking by the sea. How many times do you think Jesus went out walking by the sea? I got a feeling it's a fairly common occurrence. How often do you think Peter and Andrew and James and John threw their nets in the water and drew them back out? They were fishermen every single day. This event, the calling of the first disciples, this initiation of a movement, the first step in establishing the kingdom, then rolling the charter members of the church, happened in a routine moment. Let's compare this circumstance with a scene in Exodus chapter 3. Moses was keeping the flock of his father Jethro. Something he did every single day. Out watching the sheep. Nothing exciting about watching sheep. Sheep do the same thing that sheep do every single day. Routine moment. And you get to verse 2 and it says, "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush." See, look, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it wasn't not consumed. And Moses said, "I'll turn aside to this great sight. And why is this bush not burned?" And then the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, and the text says, God called him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And Moses said, "I'm here." Moses is going through the routine moments of life. Bushes burn on a regular basis. But there was something different about this burning bush. It wasn't consumed. Here's what I know. There are going to be times when you and I are immersed in the ordinary details of our life. Right? Riding the tractor. Cleaning the house. Washing the car. Writing out the checks. Watching the TV. Surfing the net. When God speaks to us in a routine moment of our life, I want you to realize that you need to learn to listen for the whispers. So as I'm finishing up this sermon this week, I thought about another text. I'm going to flip there to you for you and read this to you. Listen to this. Talking about Elijah. So there he came to a cave and lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I've been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, throw down your altars, killed your prophets with a sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And he said to him, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed." Listen, the Lord passed. "And a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke it to pieces and the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind." And after the wind, it says there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. "And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And Elijah heard it, and he wrapped his face in a cloak. He went out and stood at the entrance of the cave, and behold, there came to him a voice and said." Here's what I know, church. God speaks to you and I. He invites us alongside him to be engaged in ministry, take advantage of opportunity. He calls us in those quiet moments, routine moments. of our life, ordinary experiences of life. It's not always while we're worshiping in church, while we're reading our Bibles, while we're immersed in prayer. It's in those routine moments that you need to be listening for what God has to say. Not just the routine moments, but a second thought about the invitation to kingdom is it's extended to just regular people. Regular people. The text says, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net in the sea, for they were fishermen. Now think about that. You and I, we have the opportunity, the ability to read Scripture and realize what's going on. We can look back into history and know that this is the moment where Christ initiated a movement. He was equipping, he was calling men that he would equip to begin to build the church. He was calling the first men who would become the evangelist, who would share the gospel with the rest of the world throughout all of history. These are the first two men. And who would he call? They weren't rabbis, well trained in the history of the text or the content of the text or the history of the nation. They weren't historians. They weren't CEOs. They weren't PhDs. They were fishermen. Fishermen are regular folks like you and I. I believe it took some skill to be a fisherman in the first century. I mean, you had to know something about maneuvering a boat, repairing a boat, sailing a boat, navigating a boat. You had to know something about casting nets and mending nets and repairing nets and, you know, utilizing nets. You had to know something about sails. And you had to know something about catching fish and bait and where to fish and when to fish and how to fish. But here's what I know. These men had no training in church development. They had no evangelism strategy. They knew nothing about theology. They're just simple, regular folk. Here's what I know about regular folks. God calls regular folks. Let me tell you, I told you a little bit more about Annie Armstrong. I tell you about Annie because we're celebrating her ministry, honoring her legacy by collecting an offering in her name for North American missions. You've heard about Annie all your life if you're a Southern Baptist, but you may not know much about her. Annie Armstrong, Miss Annie, as she was called, was born in Baltimore, July 9th, 1850. The second youngest of five children. Not born into a wealthy family or well-known family or popular family, just a family of a couple of tobacco farmers. Her mother was a devout to the church. Her father died when she was a child. She was just a regular person who accepted the invitation to follow the king. She followed. He led her in missions. The mission field of her city, Baltimore. In Baltimore, before the age of 30, she started ministry to the minorities, to the immigrants, to the sick, and to the poor. In 1880, became a big turning point in her life. She heard a speech on the destitute conditions and the needs of Native Americans in Oklahoma. She organized a women's ministry. You know what we call it today? Women's Missionary Union, WMU. Simple woman doing extraordinary things by the power of God, following invitation in her life. She served God's people from the coast of Baltimore to the Native American reservations of Oklahoma. She's a founder and president of WMU, and she's in the Maryland Hall of Fame. A simple lady who gave her life to follow the king. You know, I realized my full-time call to ministry, maybe I was 14 or 15, but I didn't commit to following that invitation from God until I was 27 years old. I spent years wondering why God would call me. You know, I didn't get along with people real well, sort of a loner a little bit, and, why would God call me to preach and to pastor and be engaged with people that way? Had no experience in ministry, really no education at that point, no theological training, no background whatsoever. And I can't tell you how intimidated I was. The first time I walked into a college classroom, and seminary was even worse. Why would God use me? You may ask yourself that question. A lot of people ask themselves, why would God, how can God, why would God want to use me? I think I want to remind you of a text God has used in my life so many times. I want you to write over in the side of this margin in Matthew chapter 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 25 through 31. Let me read that text to you. It says, for the foolishness of God, you say, why me? For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling. That's your invitation to follow the king. Consider your invitation to follow the king, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to the worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish to shame the wise. God chose what is weak to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human might be boasting in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. So as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. You know why God calls regular people out of routine moments? So the world recognizes that God is at work. You can't take the credit. You have to turn it over to him. He can use you wherever you are. So I say to you, what are you waiting for? Start following. Follow faithfully. And here's what I know. God takes care of the rest. So we have routine moments, regular people receiving a royal invitation. An invitation from the king. Jesus goes up to these fishermen and he says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Follow me. Actually, it says in the original language text, you follow me. One word, duete. Duete. When I read that word in the original language of text, put it in English letters, it reminds me of the word duet. That's how it's spelled, much like the word duet. You know, what is a duet? It's something that two people do together. It's a song they sing together. But here's what I know. Even in that song that two people sing together, one person has to take the lead and the other person has to follow. And you know, that's exactly what following Christ is about. It's about Christ taking the lead and you and I following. Christ is our head. He is our Lord. He is our master. And he invites you and I to follow him. What's following him look like? Let's just remember what following him looks like. I think it means the first step for you and I, it means turning from sin. Becoming a Christian begins by asking Jesus to come into your life, accepting as your Savior, and being forgiven of your sins, which he freely does. You need to know the verse that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. You need to know it for you, and you need to know it so you can communicate it to others. It's giving our life to Christ, letting him be in our Savior, and then following his example. Following his example. Following Jesus' example means making an effort to do the things he did, to see people the way he sees them, to think about them the way he thinks them, to serve them the way he served them. It challenges you to love your enemies, do good to those hurt you, and give to those in need, to live a life of holiness. That's Christ's example. You know what else about following Christ is? Experiencing his protection and his provision. I love the text in John 10 where he says, the Father has given to me and I've got him in my hand and the Father's got us all in his hand. That is divine protection. That's being taken care of. Following Christ is growing in a personal relationship with him. It's not about, you know, I walk the aisle, I attend, and I give, but I'm not growing in my relationship. It's about growing in a relationship. Listen, if you're not growing, you're not following. You've got to be in a growing, dynamic, ongoing relationship with Him. You're not growing. It's about service. Following Christ is about service. It's about sharing the gospel. Follow me, He said, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, I want you to stop and think about something. What is your greatest life accomplishment to you? What do you think your greatest life accomplishment is, man? Did it happen out on the farm? Did it happen in a classroom? Did it happen in something you were building? Was it at a point of a sale or a trade? Was it some organization you led or administered? You know, our greatest life achievements, when we look back, them ought to be in the moments where we were being fishers of men, edifying someone in the kingdom, pointing somebody toward the kingdom, getting somebody to become part of the kingdom, helping other people grow in Christ. Your children, your family, your friends, your co-workers, you're fishers of men. You should be striving to reach them. Following Christ means serving and sharing the gospel. That's what being a fisher of men is all about. Actively participating in serving and sharing the gospel. We have routine moments, regular people, royal invitation, and finally, following the invitation to follow the King requires sacrifice. Look at verse 20. The text says, immediately they, Peter and Andrew, left their nets and followed Him. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. And the text says, immediately they left their boat and their father and followed Him. He invited the fishermen, and the fishermen responded. Immediately, they left their nets and their boats and their father. The text communicates to me that these men made some extraordinary sacrifices. And one of the sacrifices they made was giving up the security in the things of this world. Now let's think about it. Nets and boats equals jobs. Jobs equal income. Income equals livelihood. How many even know there's some security in having a job that produces a good income? You know that, right? And they left their security. Their father equals family. And how many of you know there's security in a healthy family? You know, that's not all they left. They left their friends, and they left their homes, and they left their comforts. They left it all. They left it all. Now, let's just think for a minute. The actions of these fishermen, I think, seem to run so contrary to modern American Christianity. Nearly everything we do in our life is done to secure us more security and more comfort. Am I right? Nearly everything we do. Why'd you go to work last week? Why did you worked your 40 hours, your 50 hours, your 60, your 70, whatever you worked last week, probably wasn't because you just love what you do. You love coming home with a hurting back and tired feet and a headache and the frustrations and the worries, and you love all that. It wasn't probably because that's why you did it. You did it because you're trying to make a life for yourself and your family, to create some level of security and comfort for yourself and the ones you love. You're trying to be happy, happy, happy. God commends hard work. He tells us to put some things away. But guess what? Those possessions and that security aren't all this life is to be about. You understand? You understand? Guess what? I think Christ enjoyed the company of His friends. I know He wept when Lazarus died, So he must have enjoyed the time he spent with him when he was alive. He felt like he had lost something. He must love the company of friends, the security of the disciples being around. You know, he took them everywhere he went. He said, I'm going to go out here and pray. I want you to stay here and watch and pray. They were partners. I think he had great joy. His family, his friends, his followers, they made him happy. He's human. I bet he enjoyed a good night's rest in a comfortable place. I bet he took pleasure in the comfort and the security of a steady meal. But his joy was in greater things. He found joy in greater things. Verse has been on my mind all week, so when I memorized years ago, Hebrews 12, 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. The text says, who for the joy, listen to this, for the joy set before him endured the cross. Sacrifice required. Joy and the sacrifice. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. He found joy in greater things than the securities and comforts of this world. I think you and I should not be people who scoff at sacrifice. We should welcome the sacrifices that Christ requires into our life. I read something this week. It kind of stuck with me. It says this. It says, if your goal in life is to maximize the joy and pleasure and comfort and success on this planet, then Christianity is not for you. Following Christ requires some sacrifice. In chapter 16, verse 24, Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. I'm going to be careful. I don't want you to understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying, based on authority in the New Testament, I am not saying that every follower of Jesus had to leave their career and sell all their possessions and leave their family and die because of the gospel. But the New Testament is absolutely clear that all who follow Jesus, then the comfort, for all who follow Jesus, the comfort and security of this world are no longer your primary concerns. Now think about it. If you're a Christ follower, Christ is your greatest concern. Being fishers of men is your greatest concern. Kingdom things become your greatest concern. And your life no longer, your career no longer revolves around you. It revolves around whatever Christ calls you to do and whatever he wants you to do to spread the good news of the kingdom. Your possessions are no longer your own. You're only stewards of the resources God has given you. You forsake the material pleasure in this world in order to live for the eternal pleasure to come. You're putting Christ first. I think the costly call to abandon Jesus Christ, to abandon everything for Jesus, can be stated another way. We lay down all things so we can live for the one thing, the invitation to follow the King. This morning, I want you to think about your life. Are you so busy that you cannot hear, you're not listening for God to speak to you in the routine moments, the interruptions of your life? Are you giving him opportunity and time to speak? And are you listening in the routine moments? Do you realize that following God only requires a humble heart willing to serve him? That's the requirement. You serve him, you follow him, you commit to him, and he equips you for the rest. You realize you've received a royal invitation. A royal invitation. Better than any other invitation you've ever received. Better than receiving an invitation to visit the White House. Better than receiving an invitation to see the Queen of England. Better than meet your granddaughter for the very first time. An opportunity to engage in something of eternal consequence for Jesus Christ, our Lord. And in that royal invitation, he may ask you to make sacrifices, things you just don't understand. Things you just don't understand. Are you willing to make those sacrifices? The invitation today is for you. God, I want to slow down. I want to hear you speak. God, I want you to use me. Here I am. God, I surrender to the royal invitation. God, I'm willing to make some sacrifices. If you need to spend some time at the altar today making, you know, a discussion with Christ about those things in your life, the altar's open during our time of invitation. Do not hesitate. Come up here. I'll pray with you. You pray by yourself. Ask somebody to come with you so they can pray too. That's what the altar is for today. Let's pray together. Bob, you come lead us in our hymn of invitation. Church, you stand, and let's respond to the word of the Lord that has been taught today. Father God, I thank you for today.